Hey, good morning, everybody from Facebook. This is Pastor Beto here from New Life Church. And, you know, every Saturday morning we come on. We usually come on at 8:30 in the morning to do our Bible school here in the mornings. But today, meeting is now streaming. Okay, now we're streaming. So we're streaming here on live stream. And the reason why we're doing that is that we're allowing everybody to come on in and just being part of this Bible Institute that we instituted there in Pakistan, and also one that we, and you know what, let me send an invitation. I totally forgot to send our invitation to Pastor Carwitha. So if you guys would just bear with me here for 1 second, I'm just gonna send that invitation to Pastor Carwitha, but hopefully Pastor Carwitha can join us here. You know what? Let me see if I can tag him here real quick in these comments. Let me see. For Pastor Carwitha, also from Kenya, and it's not letting me, for some reason, it's not letting me do it. But anyway, I guess we'll just go with this. We'll just go like that. But we got brother from India. Brother, I want you to introduce yourself, because we've been talking about something here this morning, and we're going to take a different direction here this morning, because, you know, here at New Life Church, we really, truly believe in the evangelism of our neighborhoods, of our communities, and really supplying the needs of our community. I truly believe that the church is we are responsible to fulfill the needs as Christ met the needs of the people around his area. But, you know, and that will lead to having the gospel available, available onto the world. Amen. So, you know, as we fulfill the needs of the people in our community, I truly believe that we're able to bring the real necessity. And of course, the real necessity is the gospel of Jesus Christ. So can you just give us a little bit of information, you know, tell us a little bit about, you know, who you are and there, that village, because we've been talking about how dangerous and how much the opposition is there in India. You know, here in America, we're able to do an outreach. Like right now, I have two rooms full of food and drinks, et cetera, et cetera. And we're ready to go out here into this community and give them food and give the kids toys and Bibles, et cetera, et cetera. You know, and we won't have no opposition. The only opposition that we're having right now is, of course, the guidelines, the regulations that because of the COVID-19. But it doesn't stop us from freely preaching the gospel. But in other countries, and then there in your continent, which is the continent of India, which is diversity, crazy diversity from a lot of religions and a lot of languages, amen. Tell us a little bit, because people are unaware of how difficult it is to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. But before that, I want you to introduce yourself.
Yes, praise the Lord to everyone, those who are watching on Facebook. Greetings to you in Jesus' name. I am Naveen from India. And I'm pastor, and recently I have graduated from seminary. Now I'm doing the pastoral ministry and evangelism, and sometimes I used to help the needy people, children. So in our country, especially in our village, sharing the good news to the people is very difficult, because majority of the people are Hindus. They do not accept other religions. So I would like to share a few experience what I have in our village. First thing regarding our church, when we are constructing church, all the people from our village, those who did not accept the Christ, they came to us and they have registered one case in the police station that we don't want any church in our village. So they have given a complaint to the police station, but we have prayed with believing God. And God has did a great thing that God, the policeman came and announced that every village is having the church. So there is no need of giving any complaint to the police station. It is allowed. It is right. So what happened is the all the people, those who have given the complaint to the police station, they are upset. So they are thinking that they want to do something for the church. They want to do something against the church. So they have started, those who are coming to church, they are saying that they are mocking at them. Sometimes they are saying unwanted things and they are using unparliamentary language to the believers. So because of this reason, some believers has to stop to come to church. It is a condition in our village. It is a condition in different places. And also I want to say the experience regarding the burial services. As we Christians, we used to bury the dead body in the ground. But according to Hinduism, they used to burn the dead body. So one of our believers passed away. He went to be with the Lord. So when we went to the burial ground to bury her body, what all the people did is, we don't want to bury this ground, because if you bury this body, you will ask for burial places. So we don't want to bury this place. We want to burn this one. If we burn this place, we will keep this place safe. Such a way they came upon us, some they mocked us, and finally what they have done is they buried that body, because the majority of the Christians in our village is very less. The population of Hindus is very high. So we are unable to do that thing. And even the people of the Christians, those who are believing in Christ, they have fear from the world. They have fear from the village, because the people who are opposition to Christianity, they are the authorities of our village. So whatever they say, that is correct. So we have to obedience to them. We have to do what they are saying. Such a things, this is the condition in our village and some places of our country. It's very difficult to share the evangelism. But thank God here, people used to mock, but they did not stone us. They did not beat us. But some places it is happening. They are beating up the pastors, those who evangelists, those who are going to share the gospel. They are beating they were beaten up. Some people have become martyrs for the Lord. This is the condition in India and some places of our country.
So yes. I believe that what you are experiencing is preaching the gospel in the way that it was being preached in the beginning of the New Testament, where it was house churches basically, and you were surrounded by persecution and surrounded by violence, et cetera, et cetera. You know,
one more thing I want to say that. So when we are conducting a such service in homes or in a small group in our church, so they used to keep the sound system. That means they used to keep their goddesses, the gods and goddesses songs very loudly towards our church. Such a way they used to disturb us. Such a way they used to persecute the Christians. Yes.
Wow. Yeah. And how about Brother Ratnam? Ratnam, is that? Am I pronouncing it right?
Yes. Ratnam.
Ratnam, do you guys know each other?
No.
Okay. Brother Ratnam, where are you from?
I'm in India. Nearby, it's called Vijayawada.
Okay, and Andhra Pradesh. How far away are you guys from each other? Is it India's very large, obviously.
I want Brother Navin. Which place are you staying?
Yes, I am near to Kakinada.
Okay, you are in Kakinada. Yeah, we are near 200 kilometers far away each other.
It takes 4 hours journey by train.
So that's about American. That's over 200 miles.
Yes.
Something like that. 250 miles. So that's like Dallas and Houston. So you know, we're Dallas, and then we have a neighboring city. It's Houston, but
we are neighbor cities.
Yeah, we're all brothers. And yes. Tell us, Brother Ratna, what is some of your experiences there? First of all, introduce yourself, introduce your ministry, and tell us a little bit of your experience there in your region on preaching the gospel, how difficult it is sometimes.
Yes, Pastor, my name is Ratnam. I work as right now I'm doing pastoring. 4 years back, from 4 years back, I was a Bible teacher in Bible College. And after that, I received a call, specific call for the church ministry. And I leave my job over there in Bangalore city and came to where I live, my hometown. And after my hometown, I prayed to God for almost 2 months to where I go, I should go. God lead me to go the village called Chintalapudi. It is near forest area. There is no gospel right now. When 2014, I started my ministry over there. By the God grace, and we have certain problems. As Praveen says that most of them, they are not agree to prepare the church or conducting church. People are against us. And no gospel. If we want to make a gospel tour there, it must be much more a problem. We need to take to speak people and have some other power with the villagers, elders. So as we are here and where I took place to do ministry, it is already almost where my hometown, my home place to that place, 75 kilometers. I left my house and I went to the ministry place where I am doing right now. I'm in the same place where I'm doing now in my ministry. And by the God's grace, God used me in 4 villages. By the grace of God, now we have 4 churches in some different areas.
Glory to God.
And we have some of the under us, my father is a pastor actually, and I am the first born of my family. And after that, I went to the college. I finished my theological studies. I done my MTH masters in Bangalore, India. And after that, I came. We are recognized that doing now we have under 7 pastors, they are all my cousins. My nephews, and there 4 churches has been constructed. 1 church is in under construction, and each day, weekly, 1 day I used to take class.
Yes,
Bible in church history. I took to in Ecclesiastes. Sorry, I took to the only church history, and gospels, for 4 gospels, and encourage them to do ministry. So this is my small introduction, and by the grace, and my church name is Bethel Gospel Church.
Amen. Amen. Glory to God. So, you know, just so that everybody gets a pretty good understanding of what we're doing here, you know, on Saturdays, we come out live and we do a Bible Institute that Pastor Zaya has instituted. Nice. Here in Pakistan, and then I come on and I teach on Saturdays. Also, Pastor Corwitha is with us. Pastor Corwitha is the pastor of New Life Church Kenya.
Oh,
and he's doing a tremendous job there in Kenya. And Pastor Corwitha, you mind introducing yourself and tell us a little bit about your experience there? You know, spreading the gospel, preaching the gospel there in Kenya. Pastor Corwitha. Whatever Pastor Corwitha is eating, it looks so good. You know. but Pastor Corwitha, if you can hear me, I want you to share with the people, introduce yourself, and also share with us your experiences of preaching the gospel there in Kenya. and I think he's trying to connect with the audio here. You know, I mean, we're connecting to, we're in all over the world right now, connecting and through the technology. And, you know, what the enemy meant for evil, God uses it for good. He turns it for good. So, you know, God's the creator of all things, you know. The thing is that the enemy has authority here on earth. And the authority was handed over to him because of man's disobedience, basically. And it's been our disobedience, and it's still going on. And the more we disobey God, the more we do not walk in his commandments, listen to his commandments, obey his commandments, deny ourselves, pick up our cross, and follow Christ, the more authority you give the enemy. So anyway, Pastor Corwitha, if you can hear me now, just share with the people. You know, just let us know who you are. Let us know about the ministry there in Kenya, and let us know the difficulties that has been to preach the gospel there in Kenya. And okay, we're having difficulty there, but he can jump in. Pastor, you can jump in whenever you're ready, but anyway, I just want to bring awareness to the States. I want to bring awareness to our church. I want to bring awareness to America, the difficulties and the hindrances and the obstacles and the offenses and the strife and everything that goes on all over the world. And here in America, we're privileged. We are a privileged people. We are a very blessed people here in America that if you're awakened to the gospel, if you're awakened to who Jesus Christ is, he is the Son of God, and he was crucified, he was buried, he was raised again on the third day. And if we're aware that we can do all things in Christ who strengthens us, if we're aware that greater is he who is in us than he who is in the world, if you're aware that we're in the world, but we're not of the world, if you're aware that we're just pilgrims passing through this land, and that our rest home is the promised land or the New Jerusalem, if we're aware of that, then we're awakened, and we will not cling on to the things of the world. That the church, in the Old Testament, Israel, the chosen people of God, came through Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, which Jacob became Israel, and that is the chosen people of God. And one day the church, we've been engrafted into Israel, and we're one. You know, in the Old Testament, God would use nations to pressure his children to turn their back on the world and embrace their God, their creator, their father. In the New Testament or in the church, in the grace period that we're living now, we're not literally fighting against nations or governments or people, because the Bible says that we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but powers, principalities, rulers of darkness in this world, and spiritual wickedness in the heavens or in the high places, the Bible says. So what the church is going through right now, it's a spiritual warfare, because we're not of the world. And even Jesus said, if I was from this world, you know, he's not from this world. And that this why, you know, one day he's going to establish this earth as his kingdom. And that will be his second coming. First will be the rapture, then will be his second coming. And that's where he will establish his millennium here on earth. So, you know, if we Christians here in America, if we can just grab a hold of that and know that our peace is not going to come from government, our peace is not going to come from politicians, our peace is not going to come from money, but we have peace now. We have peace with God because of Christ. So I just want to bring awareness to the whole world that we are so blessed here in America to be able to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. in the manner, in the way that we're able to do it here. As a matter of fact, an example is that today we're able to preach the gospel. I mean, even though there are COVID-19 guidelines and regulations that have been set in place by government, by our state governor, by counties, and by cities, we're still able to preach the gospel today. We're going to go preach the gospel today. We're going to go feed hundreds of people. We're going to go give toys to hundreds of kids. So we're going to do those things, and nothing's going to hinder us. The only thing that would hinder, that hinders the church, is the spiritual warfare that is around us. So if we could just be aware of that, we won't be offended of the Democrats. We won't get offended of the Republicans. We won't get offended at naysayers. We won't get offended at haters. We won't get offended at ignorant people. We won't get offended at religious people. You know, we should not get offended. This is why it's so very important that I do this on Saturdays and bring awareness to the world that there are other countries that would give anything to be in our shoes, you know. And then, of course, we would give anything to be in their shoes as well. So, you know, I know that one day, Lord willing, I will be in India. I will be in Pakistan. Amen. I will be in Kenya. Amen. You know, that is my goal. And if that's God's goal, not my will, but let his will be done. Amen. And if that's his will, he's going to provide a way, and he's going to provide so that the gospel can be preached. Because in your country of Iran or in Kenya, you know, the prosperity gospel doesn't have no place there. The name it and claim it gospel has no place there. The only gospel that has place there is the gospel of Jesus Christ. That is what we decree. You know, the decree that we declare is that Jesus is the Son of God. Amen.
Hallelujah. So
Pastor Kawitha, now that you're on board, Pastor Kawitha, let us know a little bit who you are. Let us know about your ministry there in Kenya. And let us know a little bit about the difficulties that you have faced preaching the gospel there in Kenya. Go ahead, Pastor Kawitha.
Hallelujah. Greetings Amen. To you all.
Praise Lord.
I love you. I love teaching. Hello, me too, Naveen.
Yes.
Thank you.
Yes. Pastor Kawitha, let us know about your ministry there. Let us know who you are. Let us know your ministry. And let us know the difficulties that you have faced there in Kenya preaching the gospel.
Yes, our ministry in Kenya, and only that we are being opposed by Islamists here in our country next to Somalia. But my team here, we are strong, we are preaching, and Amen. We trust each and every day. But Jesus is our victory. We preach Jesus, we Amen. Take this Amen. Word Bible to the believers, to the Islam, to the Catholics. We say Jesus, Jesus, Jesus every time we meet.
Amen.
Jesus. Amen. So there is opposition. And we are looking to Jesus to be our in the battle over the faith. We are so strong. We have the men here. We have the women team, the women ministry. We have the men's Amen. Ministry. We have the oven ministry here in our area whereby the Islamist. They killed the parents totally. And we, as a ministry, we took the children and we care them in my home. Our ministry
We have the urban ministry, we have the men's ministry, we have the women ministry, and we are praying. We say Jesus, Jesus to everybody.
Amen.
And our
Amen.
Community are happy with that. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. You know, and this is the encouragement that I get, you know, throughout the week, we as pastors, we encourage congregations, we encourage our brothers and our sisters, our family, you know, but coming here on Saturdays and I'm able to be encouraged by you guys, you know, you encourage me knowing that you are facing opposition and not opposition like, well, you just can't preach. No, but deadly opposition. You know, that you can get punished for preaching the gospel. You can get beheaded,
killed by
preaching
killed
the gospel.
Completely.
And that right there, I honor that. And this is why I want to bring awareness to America that we're living in a time where this is the time, if any, we have the freedom to go out and preach the gospel and be bold about preaching the gospel, because I truly believe that our rights as citizens here in America are being taken out slowly but surely. And these rights are going to start to be taken away. And as they implement all this confusion and they use medicine and they use science and they use illnesses and all this is the plan of the Antichrist spirit, to be able to implement laws that eventually the government is going to require for the churches not to be able to gather. They will not be allowed people to gather outside. And all this is for one purpose, and that is to bring in the false prophet. And when the false prophet comes, he is going to unite every other religion in the whole world to make it a one world religion. And when that happens, when that one religion in the world is established, mark my words, the Christian church will become an enemy to the state. It will become kidnapped by the government, by the one world order. It will be kidnapped and it will be identified. It will be identified as an enemy of the state. And it will be identified as a terrorist group. Listen to my words, because in the past, the one world order government has kidnapped the Muslim religion and has identified it as terrorists. Now, we know this, Pastor Kowita, you know this. The other pastors that are here with me today, you know this, that not all Muslims are terrorists. We know that. I know a lot of Muslims, and they're good people. I mean, they're family people. They love their children. You know, you can pray with them, and they pray with you. I know these people. I evangelized to people, to Muslims, and I've preached about Jesus in their homes, in their neighborhood, you know, and they didn't try to kill me. You hear what I'm saying? So the government has kidnapped that religion in the past. So now when you see a Muslim and they're covered, the first thing that we identify them as are terrorists. So what I'm saying is that our rights are going to be slowly taken away here in America. And the church, mark my words, will be identified, number one, as an enemy of the state. Number two, as a terrorist group. Why? Because the false prophet is organizing the one world religion for the ultimate goal of one day for the Antichrist to be worshipped as the Christ. And we know, when is that going to happen? We don't know. But the signs are there. The signs are there. And it's happening, and it's brewing. And it's brewing like a frog in warm water. And slowly, 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 the temperature is being turned up to eventually the frog gets boiled. And like I said, America is not going to be destroyed by outside is going to be destroyed by the inside. It's going to be destroyed by laws on the inside. So this is why we're here. God bless you watching us there, Pastor Zaya over there in Pakistan. And you're here. God bless you. Thank you so much. We have so many people all around the world. I got my brother Javier, Moises Javier here. You know, brother Moises, I'm very proud of this young man. He reads his Bible. He knows about the Lord. In the past, he struggled with alcohol for many, many years. And I truly believe that God has a calling in his life. And I'm proud to be called his mentor or his spiritual father. And I know that my brother Moises Javier, you know, he's God's going to take him places that he never imagined. So, Pastor Zaya, ¿cómo estás? How are you there from Pakistan?
Yes, very fine. Thanks, God. Good morning to all of you. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. Go ahead, Pastor. You want to worship? You want to worship this morning, or you already worship?
Yes, yes. We are going to worship.
Let's worship. So this morning, we're going to worship the Lord, and then we're going to have a short class here today. But I want to thank everybody who joined us this morning. We're going to continue to do this on Saturdays and bring awareness to America, bring awareness to the world that we are one church. Amen. Yes. It doesn't matter what our color is. It's not a color problem. It's not a social problem. It's not a national problem. It's not a traditional problem. It's a heart problem. So we have to preach the gospel, prophesy about Jesus Christ. Amen. So that the heart of man can, so that the heart of stone can be taken out. That is the unbelief. And the heart of flesh can be put in. That is Christ Jesus. So that the Holy Spirit can cause us to walk in the statutes of God. So go ahead, Pastor Zia. God bless you, everybody from Pakistan.
God bless you too. Wow. Praise God. Clapping. Wow. Wonderful. We are going to worship Psalm 95. Yes. Khuda de par de kha jo koi nimsa rehnda hai. Khuda de par de kha jo koi nimsa rehnda hai. Aade par dikhaye kha de.
Let me see. My brother got, I think they got disconnected, but we continue to pray. Yes. And we continue to worship in Psalms 95, where it's a call to worship. It's a call to obedience unto the Lord. You know, that the Lord is calling the church unto a worship. So we continue to worship. Yes, and they got disconnected, but I'm pretty sure they're going to come back. But like I said, God is calling us. It's a call to worship the Lord. The Bible says we are a living sacrifice. Amen. That we're not a dead sacrifice. Amen. A dead sacrifice is something religious, something that you do from the outside, something that we do or that only men can see. But a living sacrifice is from the inside out. Doing it with the love of God, where the Bible says that our work will not be done in vain. And this is a living sacrifice, being sanctified, being holy, living unto God, and living in obedience. How do we live in obedience? Well, like I said, here we go. Go ahead, Pastor. Amen. Glory to God. Glory to God. Calling on praising Him and worshiping Him. Obedience in the name of the Lord. Glory to God. Glory to God. And we continue to worship with you. We continue to worship with you right there in Pakistan. You know, we love you. We appreciate you so much. I know that we've been praying for your mom, Pastor Zia. We've been praying for your mom, and we've been praying for your congregation there in Pakistan. You're an inspiration to us. You're a personal inspiration to me, Pastor Kawita as well. Everybody here, you have a very special place in my heart. And it's a very special time for me to come on here on Saturdays, Saturday morning for us, where I'm very encouraged by your ministry. And I'm very encouraged and encourages me to go out here today with our team. We have an amazing team right now. I got a team right here behind this door right here. We're going to have about an amazing team, our outreach team, that we're going to go out there and preach the gospel, serve the people. So we're very excited what we're going to do. And we're going to start at 8:30 out there. So I only got a few minutes to be here with you guys, but I don't want to cheat you from the word of God. I want to bring the word of God as much as I can. But we've been teaching here recently. We've been teaching about who Christ is. In our Bible Institute there in Pakistan, we really want to teach, we prophesy of who Christ is, amen. And when we prophesy of who Christ is, we prophesy that he is, that he is the Messiah, that he is our Lord, that he is our Savior, and that is what we preach, and that is what we declare. We declare that is the decree that we declare, the decree that he declared is that Jesus is his son, and that is the gospel of Jesus Christ. Jesus came preaching the gospel. He said, I came to preach the gospel. He is the gospel. He was the light that the world could not understand, they could not perceive, and that is the same gospel that John the Baptist prepared the way for the Lord. As he decreased, he increased. We here as the church, we are in a spiritual warfare where the church, we must decrease. We will be strived. We will be persecuted. We will be tried to be destroyed by the world. As a matter of fact, the world will hate us because they first hated Christ. That is what is going to happen. So our warfare is not against man, it's not against government, it's not against nations, but our war is a spiritual warfare where we, the church, we will decrease, and as we decrease, he will increase. And as the church, we prophesy. Our prophetic word, our prophetic decree, amen, is amen. Jesus. There is Jesus. Come to Jesus. Come boldly to Jesus. That is our decree. That is our prophecy. Yeah. That is our teaching. That is our preaching. Amen. And as we decrease, he increases, and we're preparing the way for the Lord. What way is the church preparing? We are preparing for the rapture. The church is ready to be raptured. We don't know when, but we see the signs. We don't know when, but we live life as if it's happening right now. This is how you live life and be ready for the rapture, that we live life sanctified, holy, loving one another so that they will know that we are his disciples. And because rapture can happen in a split second. Why? Because the Bible says that he will first judge the church. Judgment of the church means rapture. Then after that, there's going to be tribulation. Yeah. We know there's going to be tribulation. Tribulation is how God will use nations, in this case, the Antichrist, to bring his children, his chosen children, Israel, and everyone else that is there to the feet of Jesus Christ. Because the Bible says that every knee will bow. And then Jesus will come and establish his millennial here on earth. But this is why the church, we must decrease so that he must increase. This is why Psalms 95, it's a call to the world to worship in obedience, amen, to be a living sacrifice unto God. Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us shout joyfully about Christ is the rock of our salvation. The Bible says that Moses said, God, show me your glory. God said, I cannot show you my glory lest you die. You must decrease so that he may increase. And he decreased and he hit him in the rock, in the cleft of the rock. That means crucifixion of Christ Jesus. We are hidden in the rock of our salvation. and the glory of the Lord pass by. Amen. So we must decrease.
Amen.
His glory may pass by. That's why he is the rock of our salvation. When Moses was interceding, when Joshua was in the valley and he was fighting, he had Ur and he had Aaron. And every time that Moses got exhausted, he got tired, what did he do? He rested on the rock. You and I, when we get exhausted, when we get tired, physically tired, we rest on the rock. And we have our brothers and we have our sisters that they lift our hands up in intercession, in prayer, in Christ, which Joshua represents Christ. He is interceding for us. He has gone before us. The glory of God has gone before us. As a matter of fact, we already have victory. All we have to do is believe. We believe that we have victory. We have victory in Christ. We are not victims. We are victorious. We must decrease so that he may increase. So he let us shout for joy. Amen. Situations can take away our temporary happiness for a while, but nothing and no one can take away the joy that we have in us, because the joy is supernatural. The Bible says that the joy of the Lord is our strength. The Bible says that through grace we are strengthened. So when we have faith in God's grace, we are strengthened. We are strengthened because the joy of our salvation, the joy of his salvation, is our strength. David said, Lord, Father, return to me the joy of your salvation. Amen. So when we are saved by grace, we are strengthened because of the joy of his salvation. So because you and because me, we are saved, we have a supernatural joy that is supernatural strength, that no weapon formed against us will prosper in the name of Jesus. No terrorist group, no religion, no antichrist spirit, no material things, nothing can take away our joy. Amen. This is why,
amen,
as the church, it is critical, 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 critical that the Spirit of the Lord is in us. And any time that you know you are convicted, because that's why the Spirit of the Lord came, that's why the Holy Spirit came, to convict us of our sin. Amen. Anytime you know that you have grieved the Holy Spirit, we repent. We are converted. The sins are blotted out. And in the presence of the Lord, the Bible says we are refreshed. So, oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. And let us shout joyfully to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before his presence. How? With thanksgiving. And with thanksgiving, they would enter the tabernacle and they would enter the gate with thanksgiving and praise. That gate of entrance represents salvation. It was salvation with different colors. Amen. The colors of our Lord Christ Jesus. And that was the entrance. That is the gate of our salvation. And we come in with thanksgiving, and we come in with praising and thanksgiving. This is why when you are born again, our attitude has to be very thankful. Because if we're not thankful, I'll go to the book of Romans with me just real quick. And I'm going to show you something about the book of Romans that teaches us and warns us about us being unthankful. And the Bible says that there is wrath on unrighteousness. In Romans chapter 1, verse 18, it says this: for the wrath of God is revealed from heaven. This wrath of God that is revealed from heaven, his name is Jesus Christ. Jesus is the wrath of God. In the book of Romans, chapter 1, verse 18, when Christ comes in his second coming, he will come with the wrath of God. The tribulation is not the wrath of God. It's the second coming that is the wrath of God. Why? Because the Bible says that Jesus will come to destroy the works of Satan. So anybody involved in the works of Satan will be destroyed by the wrath of God.
Of Jesus.
That's why it says, for the wrath of God is revealed from heaven. He is revealed. Why? Because Christ is sitting at the right hand of the Father, and he will one day leave his temple and come to bring the wrath of God upon this earth and be revealed from heaven against who? All ungodliness. Anybody who does not have the seal of the Holy Spirit. First, the church will be raptured, and then Christ will come after the 7-year tribulation, and he will come with his wrath. He is the wrath of God. He will bring judgment. He will come with fire in his eyes. He will come with a sword coming out of his mouth, and he comes as the wrath of God. He came as the lamb. Now he comes as the lion of Judah, against all ungodliness and all unrighteousness. Anybody who is unrighteous doesn't mean you're not good. Unrighteousness means that you don't believe in Christ Jesus as your Lord and your Savior. It means that you don't deny yourself. It means that you don't pick up your cross. It means that you don't follow Christ. That's unrighteousness. Righteousness means that you have been justified. You have been justified by the blood of Jesus. The blood of Jesus has justified you and justified me. Amen.
Amen.
And the righteousness, the judgment, the justification is the blood of Jesus. And the unrighteous are those who do not have Jesus, because what may be known of God is manifest in them, for God has shown it to them. So what God has manifested to us, God has manifested God. Watch this. God manifested himself in Jesus. The Bible says that Jesus is the image of God. The Bible says that he became flesh, and we beheld his glory. So he says this, because that may be known of God is manifested. Anybody who wants to know of God, that's why God manifested himself as Jesus, the Son of God, the Son of Man. God manifested. This is why when you are filled with the Holy Spirit, when the truth is preached, then the gifts of the Spirit are manifested. Well, God manifested himself, because God is spirit. God manifested himself as the Son of Man and the Son of God, so that you and I, amen, can know of his goodness. Because what? So that you and I may know him. Anytime you read in the Bible known or know or knowledge, what it means is a relationship we have with Jesus Christ. The Bible says that wisdom, that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. What does that mean? That means being born again. That means salvation. Cometh to the knowledge of the Holy One. What does that mean? That means a relationship, your relationship with Christ Jesus. And then the Bible says this, bringeth understanding. So you being saved, you walking with Jesus, following Jesus, brings you revelation of who Jesus is. In other words, it brings you revelation of who God is. Who is God? God manifested himself as Christ Jesus. The book of Colossians says that Jesus is the image of God. Known of God is manifest in them, for God has shown it to them. This is why we can shout, and we can worship, and we can obey, and we can come, and we can sing to the Lord, because he has shown us his glory. He has manifested himself to us in Christ Jesus. So we can shout, joyfully shout, and we can shout, Jesus of my salvation, the rock of my salvation. Let us come before his presence with thanksgiving. Hallelujah. That is salvation. That is our Lord Jesus Christ. For since the creation of the world, this is Romans chapter 1, verse 20. For since the creation of the world, the Bible says, his invisible attributes are clearly seen. God is spirit. God created all things. In the beginning was the earth. In the beginning was the heavens. He created all things. God is spirit.
Yes.
And because of that, the creation of the world, his invisible attributes, everything you see God. Because God is spirit and God is invisible, but you see the creation, his creation. Amen. We do not come from monkeys. We do not come from this accidental bang. No, God created every single cell in us. He created every single thing in us. He created us with his own hands out of the dust of the earth. He breathed his breath into us. He breathed his inspiration in us. That's why the Bible says that the word is the inspiration of God. It is his breath. So when you and I, when we read his word, guess what? We are inspired. We can breathe the inspiration of God. The word is the inspiration. It gives us life. Without respiration, without breathing, you and I, we die. In other words, without the word of God, you and I, we die. We are dead. There is eternal life, but in damnation without Christ. But with Christ, there is eternal life with him. Glory to God. For since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. Now that Christ has come, we have no excuse. In the Old Testament, Christ had not yet come. Christ had not yet been revealed. This is why the last will be first. This is why the church will be judged first. Then God gives tribulation, allows tribulation, so that his chosen people, amen, can come back to him. The church is everybody, is the Gentiles, is everybody and anyone who has heard the gospel of Jesus Christ. We have no excuse. Too much is given, much is required. That's what the Bible says. So for since the creation of the world, his invisible attributes are clearly seen, being understood. You know what that says? What's this? Being understood is revelation of who Christ is. Remember, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. That's salvation. Yes. Cometh to the knowledge of the Holy One. That is sanctification. That is a relationship with Christ. And bringeth understanding. That's what the Bible says, being understood. That is revelation. That's your eyes being opened, and now you see Jesus, the image of God. Amen. Manifested. God manifested himself as the Son of Man, as the Son of God. Amen. That is God. You know, what must I do to be saved? Repent. Repent. Amen. And be born again. And be baptized. What does baptism mean? Baptism means that the old man dies and the new man is born again. That is baptism. Hey, Pastor Josh, God bless you.
Yes.
Good, good.
Hello? Yes.
Okay, that's fine.
Yes.
Aquí estamos. Aquí estamos. Okay, God bless you. God bless you. Yes, sir. That is my friend, Pastor Josh. He's on his way to do some worship with us. Man, we're getting ready to preach. We're getting ready to worship. I'm so excited. I'm going to have to cut it short, guys, because I got to go out there and we're going to go preach.
Sure, sure.
But I love you. I love you. I love you. I'm going to continue to teach you all.
Thank you.
This, remember, just take this with you. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Bringeth knowledge of the Holy One. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. You cometh to the knowledge of the Holy One and bringeth understanding, salvation, sanctification, life. In the tabernacle, you come in through the gate. That is salvation. He is the way. The holy place is the truth. The holies of holies is life. He is the way. He is the truth. He is the life. The fear of the Lord. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Salvation, knowledge is sanctification, relationship with Christ Jesus, and bringeth understanding. That is revelation, and that is life. That's eternal life. Our eyes are open. We're not asleep. Now we got to go tell the whole world that there's only one way. There's only one truth and one life. Amen. That is it. We have the answer. The church, we have the answer. There's only one answer, and his name is Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Pastor Naveen, do you want to close for us? Close in prayer for us.
Yes.
Go ahead.
Let's celebrate prayer together. Our Heavenly Father, once again, we thank you so much for the wonderful class which you have given to us, Father Lord. We are thanks so grateful to you to blessing us through your word, through your wisdom, Father Lord. Thank you for your word to give us. And also we are praying for Pastor Beto for taking his time, his own time to spending with us, Father. We are praying for him. We are praying for his ministries, and we are praying for the church and the family, Father Lord. We pray that you may bless his family abundantly, Father Lord. Make him a channel of blessing for many, Father Lord. Thank you so much. And also we are praying for all the members, those who are participating in this class of Father Lord. We are praying for whether who are used from Kenya. And also we are praying for the Moses Javier. And we are praying for Brother Ratnam. And we are also praying for brother from Pakistan, Chia. We are praying for all the members who are participating. And also we are praying for those who are watching in the Facebook, we are praying for them. Father Lord, bless in your name, Father Lord. We thank you once again. Thank you for your class. We are so grateful to you once again, Father. We are submitting all members into my hand. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Amen. Thank you so much, everybody. We love you.
Thank you so much.
Stay
love you too.
In contact. God bless you, everybody. Everybody, God
thank
bless
you so much.
You continue to stay
okay,
in contact.
Bye-bye.
And God's going to provide. God's going to provide.
Yes.
Let's unite. Amen. And let's do what the Lord calls us to do. We love you in the name of Jesus.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Amen. Amen. Love you too. Bye.